Well, we certainly have been talking a good bit about Israel, so maybe it's time to listen to someone from Israel. Ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to introduce the Counselor for Political Affairs at the Israeli Embassy here at Washington, Eliav Benjamin, who's enjoyed a very, very busy career. He held the key job of policy advisor to the Director General of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, head of the Deputy Director General's Office for Public Diplomacy. He was also for 4 years Deputy Head of Mission in Shanghai, China, and for 2 years in the 1990s, he was Head of PR and Cultural Affairs in the Israeli Economic and Cultural Office in Taipei and led activities for the Taiwan Jewish community. Now that should have been real fun. Counselor, it's your pleasure.
My only problem with this hour is that my mother isn't awake at this hour to see it in Israel, or my father for that matter. But thank you very much, Marvin. Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Ambassador Shifter. Thank you, Rabbi Fishman. V'hi she'amda l'avoteinu v'lanu. This is just before Pesach, just before Passover. She who stood up for us, for our forefathers and for us. Of course, there is the question of who is she? And I'd like to offer a few suggestions. She is a Jiri who, led by Ambassador Shifter, has been dealing with promoting Israel's case in the UN for centuries, nearly, at least decades, and really fighting relentlessly on Israel's behalf at the UN, in Congress, with the administration, and with so many countries around the world. Vehi, she, is also Senator Cardin, who has taken up this issue, the cause for Israel, explaining that it's not just the cause for Israel, this is in the US's strategic interests, and especially with what has been going on over the past year and a half with the Palestinians' attempts to walk away from the table of negotiations and to take their cause to the UN, thinking that this is what is going to give them a state and thinking that this is what is going to give them peace and security and looking for any possible excuse not to come back to the table. Vehi, she, is definitely Ambassador Marlene Moses, a very dear friend, who together with colleagues, some of them also sitting here in this room, understands. She understands that things are beyond politics and things are beyond deals behind closed doors. And the issue of Israel is much greater than just bashing it and looking for ways for more resolutions against it in every single forum possible. And true, it means that some of these countries, unfortunately, are in a minority, in a great minority. This is the unfortunate case, this is the unfortunate story of the United Nations. You may recall Prime Minister Netanyahu, who just at this last General Assembly session in September, when speaking of the UN, said, if you look at the votes and if you look at the automatic majority that so many countries enjoy, you can think about the fact that countries will decide that it's daytime right now, they will have the automatic majority, and yes, the UN has decided it is now daytime outside, and vice versa. The term Israel under siege is something that is difficult for an Israeli to live with, true as it may be. True as it may be, as an Israeli officer in the paratroopers who realizes this, And true as it may be, if we look at the international community and the international arena and the UN, where although there are a few good things about the UN, I must say, but at the end of the day, Israel is singled out. And there are a few good things about the UN, because if you look at the UN's agenda, it is quite diverse. You have on the agenda right now, the Secretary General is traveling to Southeast Asia, dealing with issues there. The UN is dealing with Sudan and South Sudan. It's dealing with sustainable development. It's dealing with climate change, with diseases worldwide, and so on and so forth. But together with that, if we look at every international fora where Israel is engaged with or in through the UN, where Israel feels it has something to bring to the table from a professional point of view, politics are thrown back at us. And if we look at the UN agenda, it's difficult not to notice that on the 27th of March, for instance, there is the Palestinian Committee, led by Hanan Ashrawi. In May, there is the Palestinian Committee for Youth at UNESCO. And there are umpteen resolutions that pass year in and year out against Israel. Just to give you an idea, resolutions in the UN General Assembly, and Ambassador Shifter knows this far better than I do, it's much easier to bring a resolution to the table than it is to get rid of it after a few years. Apparently, I just learned this last week, there is a resolution that has been in effect since 1981 when Israel attacked the Iraq nuclear facility, and every single year there is a resolution condemning Israel for this, since 1981. ...92 resolutions at the Human Rights Council. 39 of them against Israel. Over the years. The Human Rights Council hasn't been in existence so many years. How many resolutions against Iran? One. How many against Syria? Four. And that is only since recent months. But again, what we saw over this past weekend, or past week, where, true, the US was able, not very easily though, to pass a resolution against Sri Lanka on human rights, with a majority of 24 to 15. But there were no less than five resolutions against Israel at the same Human Rights Council. And I'd like to just go through them quickly. A resolution about violation of human rights passed 44 to 1. I'll let you guess who the one was. Israel is not a member there, by the way. Two abstentions, Cameroon and Guatemala. Follow-up for Goldstone. Goldstone, right? What is it now? 3 years since the caste-led operation, which started not because we were looking for a fight, not because we were looking for a battle, but because, as Senator Cardin mentioned, seeing what is going on in Israel, and as we heard Ambassador Moses, who visited Sderot, spoke about the people living there with fear, and with my brother who lives literally the closest village just north of Gaza, puts on his Facebook, everything is on Facebook today, writes on Facebook on a Friday night, something must be crazy in this world if I have to live and spend a Friday night in a shelter with my wife, my 2-year-old son, and my 11-year-old son. So yes, Israel had to do something in Gaza. Goldstone came, Goldstone is still there, another commission, another resolution, And that passed 29-1. 17 abstentions on this one. The Golan Heights, another resolution that comes in every single session at the Human Rights Council. The Human Rights Council meets 3 times a year. The Golan Heights, let's remember what's going on just beyond the Golan Heights, Syria. Well, the Syrians took the floor on that one, complaining against Israel's violation of rights. That passed 33-1. 13 abstentions on that one. Guatemala, by the way, which is now a member of the Security Council, a non-permanent member of the Security Council, abstained on all of these, which was a result, a direct result of a very, very close engagement that we all have been holding with them. All, I mean, Ajiri, all, I mean, members of Congress and the administration, and all, I mean, of course, Israel. So these are things that are going on not in New York, and not only in New York, but at the Human Rights Council. And of course, the icing on the pudding, if you want, was this nothing less than crazy resolution passed about the settlements and about calling for a fact-finding mission to the settlements to investigate how Israel is abusing the human rights of people because of the settlements. 36-1. 10 abstentions on this one. Even some members of the European Union voted in favor of this. So this is just a small example of things that we are dealing with. And I didn't even mention UNESCO. UNESCO, an organization that I would just like to guess that up to about a year ago, most of us around this room didn't exactly know what it was dealing with, unfortunately, I must say, because UNESCO is a very important UN body. It deals with promoting culture issues and education and scientific issues across the globe. And Israel is a part of UNESCO. Hey, Israel has an expert at UNESCO dealing with Holocaust remembrance and Holocaust education, which, of course, is not an Israeli issue, but who else apart from the Jewish state, perhaps, to lead this? And here is where in UNESCO, we all remember, the Palestinians managed and pushed for a full membership recognized as a state. And they succeeded because they have an automatic majority. They succeeded not because we didn't try pushing it off the table, not because the US did not attempt in every way possible to make it very clear to the Palestinians what they were doing to themselves and what they were doing to the organization, what they were doing to countries that were recipients of aid through UNESCO. But this is what the UN is about. And one may ask, okay, so maybe Israel should say, okay, that's it. Go back to the days of David Ben-Gurion. Shmum, we're having nothing to do with this. But Israel can't afford not to be there. Israel has so much to offer. And I'm saying this with modesty to the international community in the developing world and the developed world. But I believe that we are seeing some small sheds of hope, if you want. And again, a lot of it, thanks to the work that Algeria are doing and other friends across the globe who really get it, who understand that abusing what the UN stands for is detrimental to the UN itself, and is detrimental to the cause of the countries. Unfortunately, there is one group of countries, which is basically the largest group of countries, nicknamed the NAM, the non-aligned, 77 countries, who don't necessarily get it. And as it was alluded to earlier on this evening, yes, there are all these deals and I'll scratch your back, you scratch my back kind of thing. But even within the NAM countries, I would like to raise one absurdity that is coming up in the next few months, which is that the leader or the president of the NAM, the future president of NAM, is no less than Iran. Yeah. And if there's one thing that I would like to take out of this amazing evening here, is perhaps to try and shed some light on that and try and speak to countries who are also members of NAM to show the absurdity of this grouping of 77 countries being led by Iran. And let's stop with these deals, and let's stop with all these calculations, but let's start thinking about the UN and voting within the UN and deal and promoting the UN issues on things that the UN really should stand for. And these are values and issues that countries in the Pacific get, that countries in the Caribbean get. The US gets it, Israel gets it. Let's try and expand this one. Thank you.